And thanks for having me here today. They told me that my role, first of all, is to wake you up after lunch. So I will try to do that. And on top of it, then, I will try to share with you what we're up to at PepsiCo, what is design and design thinking in a big multinational corporation like PepsiCo, why we're doing it now, who is doing it, and how we're doing it. So first of all, why? We live in a world that is radically different than just a few years ago. Everything is changing with an acceleration never experienced before. And there are a variety of different drivers of this acceleration. Some that are really, really relevant for what we're doing as designers. First of all, internet. Internet is creating what I like to define as global access to knowledge. You have a question about anything, you take out this device, you search your answer on it, and you have them. This is creating consumers that are more and more connected, they are savvy, they are demanding, often spoiled. So it's changing completely the people we are talking to. The global market is creating global accessibility to purchase. Essentially, you still go eventually to a store, you experience the product, you experience the service, the customer service that there is in the space, and then once again, you take out your device, and eventually, you buy from competitors. And it's happening. And this, you know, the first business, the first area that's been suffering of this has been the consumer electronic world, but more and more, this is spreading everywhere. This is creating a scenario where we don't compete anymore just with other brands and products on the same shelf, but we compete with products and brands without any boundary of space. This is, for instance, for us in food and beverages, happening more and more and more. I live in New York City, and the most of my grocery shopping is actually happening online on an app. And then I go to a store when I want to have a specific kind of experience, when there is something unique that happened in the kind of store. So an amazing opportunity both for retailers and for the e-commerce digital world, and an amazing opportunity for the designers to design new experiences, both physical and digital, for our customers. Then there is the world of social media that is changing completely the way people talk with each other, connect with each other, and connect with brands. Essentially, social media are creating what I like to define as the filtration and amplification of information that are relevant to you. So essentially, you choose your peers, people that share the same kind of dreams and passion and interest, and you allow them to be part of your community in LinkedIn, in Snapchat, in Instagram, in Facebook, and so on and so forth. By definition, then, they will filter information that are interesting for you, and then will amplify them endless times. This is creating a situation where we as brands are not the actor of the conversation anymore. We're actually the topic of the conversation among consumers. It's changing completely the way corporations and startups build brands. We're moving from a model where we, as brand, as companies, we were crafting a message and delivering the message one way, top-down, to consumers, mostly through a TV channel, if you have the means, to the resources to buy the space, to a model where we cannot buy the ride anymore. We need to earn it. A model where we don't talk to people anymore. We are, once again, the topic of the conversation, and we need to understand how to be as relevant as possible to be able to be part of the conversation. Then there is this bucket that we could divide in different buckets, but essentially is the idea of a world of digitally enabled communication, entrepreneurship, and manufacturing. Essentially, it's the idea of each of you having a good idea for a new product, a new brand, and then getting funding relatively easily compared to the past. Think about internet sites like Kickstarter.com, where you place an idea online and you get funding for that idea. Or anyway, an easier access to funding in general. And then you can build your products in an easier way than in the past. Manufacturing cost is decreasing, the cost of tooling is decreasing. 3D printing will change even more that kind of scenario. So it's really easy. You don't have the barrier to the entrance from a manufacturing standpoint anymore. And finally, you can build your system of communication not even from your garage, you know, like it happened in the 50s and 60s, companies like Apple created in a garage. Today, from your living room, your bedroom, you know, with your laptop, you can create your system of communication leveraging, once again, internet and social media. So this is creating a landscape of competition that is completely level. It's completely different than in the past. Brands like Pepsi don't compete anymore with just another cola brand up there, you know, an ultra multinational corporation. We do compete with so many new entrants. There is a proliferation of competitors that we need to consider when we design our products and brands. And finally, Internet of Things, essentially objects that are becoming smarter and smarter and smarter and more connected with each other, are changing again the scenario. We'll have a future where our bottle will communicate directly to the refrigerator that it's time that the product inside is expired or it's time to be replaced or replenished, and will order directly itself, you know, through an e-commerce channel, or a world where you put a glass on a table and the table will understand if the glass contains a coffee or a cold drink and will warm up the glass or will refrigerate it. So essentially, it's a world that is totally changing, that is evolving, and people, therefore, are different. They behave in a different way with our products and brands. They don't buy actually products anymore. They buy experiences that are meaningful to them. They buy solutions that are holistic, that transcend the product, that go beyond the product, and mostly they buy stories that need to be authentic. Every word in this slide has a specific meaning and impact on what we do every day. More and more people, you know, without going in the detail of all these numbers, but people want to buy experiences, and we need to understand how to provide those experiences as brands to them. Consumers, playing with the words, consuming content at the speed of light. We need to produce content with a very high frequency. We don't compete anymore just with another cola brand in a brand like Pepsi. We compete with the latest song of Beyoncé. We compete with the latest telephone from Samsung or Apple. We compete for mindshare and relevance in the life of people, transcending our product. Content for us is a new product, is a new packaging, is a collaboration with a star in the music world, in the sport world, is an event, is an experience that we enable consumers to have with our brands. And we said it, you know, we are not the actors of the conversation, we are the topic of the conversation. What are the challenges of this? You know, looking back, I joined PepsiCo about 5 years ago, and the main challenges we had in the past 5 years have been, one, how to be relevant. In a world where relevance changes almost day by day, people are interested and in love with new things because they're bombarded by new things, by new content every day. So how to be relevant? And what is relevant for people? What is relevant? We live in a world where it's not anymore about commissioning the next marketing research and will take a few months. We arrive, you know, you will get back the book with all the information, and then you try to apply them to your world. You need to understand how things are changing every day. You need to be immersed in that kind of moving and trending world. And then you need to move fast. So the old approach to innovation brand building that was sequential and was very kind of slow, if you want, doesn't exist anymore. We're not in a crisis mode. It's just a different kind of world. We need to move fast. And then finally, we need to be authentic. And it's so easy to be authentic for a small startup, for an entrepreneur, because that person is going to infuse his sensitivity across every touch point of the brand. But it's so difficult when you need to scale it up. It's so difficult for a brand like Pepsi to be authentic across the world when we activate the brand thousands of times every day. When that brand is in the hands of consumers in an aisle of Walmart, and the day after is in the hands of Lady Gaga's Super Bowl, and the day after is in the hands of a model at Fashion Week in Shanghai or in Milan, how can you be consistent in who you are and then slightly change your behavior, your execution, your activation to be relevant in the cultural and geographical context you are in? These are the big challenges we are facing and where we are trying to leverage design, and we show you in what way in the past few years, if the clicker works. So first of all, we say that we design experiences. We don't design products anymore, we design experiences. What is an experience? Well, an experience is people, so our consumers, our users, in interaction with a solution. It could be a product, a service, a brand, name it, is a solution. In a context, in a physical and intellectual and digital space, the context of purchase and then the context of use, in time. By definition, an experience is a story. We hear so much talking about storytelling. Don't ask designers to design packaging or products. Ask designers to design those stories. Designers to design those experiences. Designers to design that practical or pragmatical journey of experience that people have with your brand and with your products. From the idea of purchasing something to purchasing it, receiving it, using it, storing it, and dismissing it. Or if you think about the space, in our case, we design spaces with our customers. So a restaurant or retail space, or you know, could be the interior of a car. So it is the idea of going to the restaurant versus another one, to the store versus another one, then seeing it from far away, then you enter, the moment you enter the door, you interact in the space the first few seconds, then you leave in the space, is the time you pass in the space, and finally you leave from the space. For us, it's very important because this is how we think about the experience with our brands, also in relation with our customers. So if I talk with a customer that is a retailer or is in the hospitality world, is an hotel, we think in the way, we don't propose them just, you know, buy that packaging because it's so cool. We design with them the overall journey of the people and how our brands can help the customer and how the customer can help us, giving access to our brand in the most meaningful way to our consumers. And this needs to happen, it's not very visible, but you know, across every touch point of the brand, product, packaging, communication, digital, every single touch point need to tell in a consistent way that authentic story about the brand. Now, if this is true, we want to design experiences. How do you design the meaning of that experience? What is the meaning of that experience? You heard so many times designers telling you, we don't design products, we design meaning. There are entire books written about this. Well, every time you interact with a brand or a product, it could be a luxury car, it could be a luxury fashion brand, or it could be a mass market brand. There are two levels of interaction, so people with the product or the brand. The first one is you and the product or the brand. It's your personal pleasure or sense of reassurance or love that you have when you interact with a brand that you really care about. Is imagine for the women in the audience when you buy a pair of Prada shoes, there is not even the brand outside, and you just love it. Imagine, you know, think about something that you really, really love, and the moment you buy it, you purchase it, and that feeling that you have in your guts. The second level of interaction is what that product or that brand is telling about you to others. So everything that surrounds us, you know, the shoes I'm wearing today, my watch without hands, my crazy shirt, the car I drive, the office I have, the tattoo I may have that I don't have, everything that surrounds us is telling a story about us to the rest of the world. And so as designers, we design the conversation that happened between you and the product and between the product and the brand and the rest of the world. Sometimes we are direct, the story as people, we are direct, you know, the story we're telling the world. Many times we don't, but we do have that inner feeling and an inner need of telling stories to the world through what we wear and we surround ourselves from. And so this is what designers do. They design that conversation and the story that we tell to the world. So for instance, in the case of food and beverage, today, you know, to work with a premium brand of water or a low-cost brand of water, you are communicating a different kind of idea to the rest of the world. Working with a cola versus a juice versus a water, once again, you're communicating something to the world just by walking around with something. Every brand has a badge value, no matter the category, each and every time. So we say we need to design experiences, not just product. Those experiences need to be meaningful to people. Now, how do we do? Well, I may speak for 10 hours about this or more, but this is one of the multiple point of views of how to design a meaningful kind of experience. And this is what I like to call the emotional flow that overlaps completely the practical journey, the practical flow I mentioned earlier. This is coming from the theories of a human scientist, Donald Norman, reinterpreted in the world of brands. So Donald Norman talks in a book called Emotional Design about three steps of interaction you have with people and spaces. The first one is when you see a beautiful woman or a beautiful man or a beautiful landscape and you're like, wow, it's the butterfly in your stomach, is, you know, that feeling that transcends completely your rationality. It's what I like to call the visceral relation. You see a product, you don't even know what the product is, but you're just attracted by it, or eventually you hate it. But it creates a reaction in you. It could be, you know, a vintage line of 7-Up, And every time, it's not just the product. We talk about the ecosystem of experiences. So that translates to licensing, translates to communication, digital, physical. It could be one of the latest brands that we just launched is Life Water. Essentially, is a premium mass brand of water where every piece of packaging is a collaboration with an artist. We will deliver, we launch multiple collections. This is the first one we launched a month ago with three different artists, and every quarter we launch new collections. But once again, it's not just a piece of packaging. First of all, talking about meaning, self-expression, this is really that. It's really about enabling people to express themselves, is differentiation, is discovery, because this will keep changing the market. But then is everything else that happened around it, from water bars to collaboration with famous fashion bloggers or brands, all the way to, for instance, this was the launch of Life Water the two nights before Super Bowl. We are one of the sponsors of Super Bowl in the United States with a concert of Bruno Mars. But is the overall experience, is a brand that authentically wanna sponsor creativity and design. We have in the committee Anna Wintour, we have Paolo Antonelli, the director of MoMA. We really want to do it in an authentic way. And this is just one example, but this spread across every brand, even the more traditional brands, if you want. This is Quaker, the redesign of the brand. And now we're thinking about the experience in store, or you know, with a variety of different customers. So transcending that, an experience eventually in a Quaker store, in a breakfast bar, in a space where we really take that experience to the extreme, we create the perfect interaction with our brand, and then we activate conversation that can be amplified online in a variety of different ways. It's products, but then it's also campaign. This is Pepsi Emoji for Pepsi, a very successful campaign of last year where every bottle become an emoji. Once again, thinking about how you can Instagram, you can share in social media the product. Once again, talking about global, but then also local. So this idea of glocalization, in this case, with different kind of emoji that change country by country. And once again, not focusing just on the product and the packaging, but creating a full ecosystem of products and experiences. This is a collaboration we did with Jeremy Scott, the famous fashion designer, on creating a line of eyewear inspired by the emoji. And we did a variety of other things in that kind of way. The second step of interaction is what I call the interactive relation. So the first one, the visceral, you know, you see this beautiful man or woman, you love them, you love to see, you know, that beautiful landscape. Now all of a sudden you are with them and you enjoy the kind of interaction both at a rational level and an emotional level. Is, you know, you sunbathing in Maldives or in Bahamas and thinking about your colleagues back in New York under the snow is rational and emotional. It's always that balance between rationality and emotions that is so, so important. In a product like this fountain, is essentially a digital fountain where you select your drinks. It could be a water, it could be a tea, it could be a cola, and then you add flavors and you customize your drinks. So you can create hundreds of different kind of drinks, and this kind of machine gives us insight on what the people is creating, you know, instantly. So we know everything. We have a picture real time every day of what people is creating. These are all information that we feed into our innovation machine. We can push content to them through the machine, but mostly the challenge was how to make it very, very engaging so that people will fall in love with it, will play with it, will consume, you know, more drinks through it. But in the meantime, we needed to keep the speed of transaction for our customers. We needed people to move fast in front of this machine. So the balance between rationality and emotions, aesthetic and functionality, is so key in what we do as designers. And we always need to keep it in mind. And this applies to everything. You know, this is the entire family of digital equipment, or to, you know, digital equipment is for us synonym of mass customization. Consumers want to customize their experiences, their products, their drinks. This is an example of that. A totally sustainable proposition is called Drinkfinity. Essentially, it's a bottle that you can reuse, reusable bottle with pods, with dual chambers. One part is a liquid, one part is a physical, is could be a seed, it could be coffee beans, it could be tea leaves. And so you fill the bottle with water, you put the pod in, you shake it, and you get your own drink. This has been extremely successful. We launched it first in Brazil. We're going to launch it in other countries this year. That same technology and the idea of customization is what we have been taking then to the world of Gatorade. And I have a video that will tell you what we're doing with Gatorade that is much more eloquent than me.
Your game is our lab. Introducing the future of sports fuel. Gatorade GX, your real-time hydration coach. Gatorade GX tracks fluid loss before, during, and after training. Capturing every moment of sweat. Measuring electrolyte and sodium loss in real time. Fluid intake is continually monitored with on-the-fly guidance, showing you when to hydrate while pacing your intake. Analyzing your fluid balance, Gatorade GX unlocks your personal fuel strategy. Recommending fuel formulas based on your electrolyte and carbohydrate needs. Conveniently delivered through an innovative equipment system. Replacing what's been lost when you need it the most. Track, analyze, and optimize your performance. Gatorade GX. Built to fuel, customized for you.
And this, I think, is an interesting example of mass customization, of technology that is starting to enter the life of each of us. And it's also an interesting example of why we're testing innovation. We started with pro athletes that were in our paycheck because they were our endorser and testimonials. The national soccer team of Brazil, Serena Williams, Usain Bolt, and then from them we moved to colleges, and now we're launching in mass retail. And this is an approach we use in a variety of different brands. This is another example of thinking about a product that we have today. This is the world of sodas, and try to understand how to reignite passion and love for that world, leveraging design to build unexpected experiences. This is Fizz, grab life by the bubbles, irreverent already in this definition, and this is the idea of creating this Willy Wonka kind of experience where even the glass is not just a glass anymore, it becomes a sphere, so that once again you take out this device and you're going to share it with your friends. I have a video that tells you what Fizz is.
So what is Fizz? It's a whole new way to look at soda.
This is not a drink, it's really an experience.
I'm excited to introduce you to the world of Fizz. Fizz is a whole new way of looking at soft drink mixology, which we like to call Fizzology.
They have these cool machines here called Pepsi Spires. They're already flowing now. What were you feeling?
Batter up.
And then you take it over to these Fizzologists. These guys are taking the most unexpected flavors and creating the most imaginative drinks you can possibly imagine. Check it out.
They're loving getting to interact with it, what goes into it that makes it, watch something be created, and then get to consume it.
It was nice to see it made in front of your eyes. You got to do it and then eat what you made.
I love it. Really innovative.
Awesome. It was just cool to see it all come together.
My favorite part was watching them put all the toppings.
A delicious drink.
Getting a great taste.
I love it. I love the flavor.
This is not just a drink. It's an experience.
It's been a really exciting day so far. As you can see, we're flowing now.
Three, two, one.
And Fizz is very interesting because essentially, you know, in a world where we need to innovate, and we need to experiment, and we need to, anyway, we have responsibilities in front of our shareholders, in front of the company, so we need to be very careful in how we take risk, but we do need to take risk. Fizz is an example of how we test and experiment. Essentially, Fizz was launched for the first time at the Makers Fair in New York City, the Innovation Fair of New York City. It's been extremely successful. We aligned us 2 hours of people to try these drinks. We won the best innovation of the Innovation Fair. But what is interesting was, you know, it was a communication event with a specific ROI on that communication event. But in reality, for us, was a way to prototype an idea we had in mind and test it and see how consumers, customers, media, influencers, anybody would react to that. By getting this feedback, we tweak the ideas and we take them to the next level, but mostly we build confidence. Confidence is a key word. In a world where you need to decrease and moderate and control risk, inner confidence of leaders, business leaders, human beings is so important. And these kind of ways of prototyping ideas, leveraging communication events where you have a specific communication ROI is magic in taking, you know, design to the next level. And this is when we talk about design thinking, this is what design thinking is about, prototyping experiences in a variety of different ways. So we say we are talking about the three steps, the three relations of people with people, products, and context. First one, visceral. Second, interactive, emotional and rational interaction. The third one is what I call the expressive relation. So essentially, you're in the analogy of Norman, you're so happy of going out with this woman and this man, you talk to everybody about them. You know, you talk about your friend, to your friends, to your family. You're back from your vacations and you show the pictures of your vacations to everybody. It's about you being so happy or proud of that experience that you want to share that with the rest of the world. It's about you being so satisfied by being associated to a family of products of a brand that you want to talk about this to others. This is our portfolio of health and wellness brands and the identity we're creating, both visual, graphic, and 3D, three-dimensional, for that portfolio brand to really push those kind of more healthy, good-for-you products into the market with our customers and retailers. This is an activation we did, for instance, in Houston before Super Bowl. And is thinking about a brand and understanding how to make it as relevant as possible to people so that people want to be associated to the brand. This is the, in occasion of the Soccer World Cup, we created this campaign where essentially we were not the main sponsor of the competition, but we had a variety of different athletes that we were sponsoring. One of these is Lionel Messi. So we had this fashion photographer, Danny Clinch, taking pictures black and white of these players. We had street artists from the different regions of the athlete in a live performance in London, painting over the picture of the athlete and creating that campaign. That has been extremely successful. Out of the art, then we build collaborations with a variety of different fashion brands, like Del Toro shoes, Penguin jackets, Bang & Olufsen headphones, Shot skateboard, and so on and so forth, creating products that then we sold in Bloomingdale's in the United States, in Colette in Paris, in a variety of premium retailers around the world. Once again, why? To build that kind of conversation, to create relevance and then be part of that conversation. This cannot be one operation. We need to do many, many of these things. But when we say we don't talk to people anymore, we need to do things. It's not just about sponsoring, but it's about doing things. This is an example of what I was talking about. This is Shanghai Fashion Week, and we became sponsor a few years ago. It's the can, but then we give the possibility to designers to create their own collection, go on stage, inspired largely by Pepsi. Essentially, we ask them to use the three colors of the brand and then do whatever they want to do. And then we support them and we push them. Or, for instance, this is the movie, Back to the Future 2, Marty McFly, Michael J. Fox, in his future, was going to a bar and asking for Pepsi Perfect. We've been leveraging that product placement, that early product placement, creating this Pepsi Perfect. We sold it online on October 21st, 2015. That was the future of Michael J. Fox in Back to the Future. And it's been super successful. It sold out in seconds when we placed it online. And this is the bottle, you know, a few months later, sold for $100, $200, and even more online. I usually point out that in that picture, there is not even the soda inside. There is not even the cola inside. So the power of packaging in that case. But in reality, it's the power of understanding how to be culturally relevant. This is Cola House. It is essentially a space where you go and you can experience cocktails based on cola nuts. They don't taste like cola. Is the romancing about the story of colas and one of the ingredients of colas that is this cola nut. We create these drinks with this crazy biochemist with a PhD in biochemist this crazy guy from Brooklyn that used to consult for NASA, creating drinks for the astronauts. So it's about a product experience, but then it's also an experience in the location. We bring to the location events, concerts, fashion shows. So it's about creating the connection with the cola brand that is really what Pepsi stands for. With Pepsi, almost invisible to you. It's gonna be consumers that will tell the story. It's not about us imposing the brand to your face. And from an experiment that we did in Milan Design Week a few years ago, this is permanent cola house in the Meatpacking District in New York City. And then experiences like Super Bowl. Super Bowl that for many companies was just for us was the halftime show. We are the main sponsor of the halftime show. This year was the Pepsi Zero Sugar halftime show. You know, I think is a sign of the evolution of times. But it is becoming more and more than just the ad during the game. Super Bowl for many companies involved in that event is becoming really the journey from when customers, consumers, influencers land in the city of Super Bowl. What happened when they take that taxi or that Uber or that mean of transportation to the hotel? What happened in the hotel? What happened in those days before the game? So we designed the overall journey, the overall experience, with the idea that 5 years ago was not that relevant. It was important, but you know, today, through social media, that experience can be amplified endless times. Eventually, even more times than the halftime show Super Bowl, or for sure of the other Super Bowl. So it's powerful what social media are enabling us to do. From the special edition, limited edition can, to all the line of products we do around the halftime show, to concerts we organized before the show, and a variety of different activations. Actually, I show you a video, we'll tell you the story of it. If we go back to these three steps of interaction, you know, when I talk about them, everybody in the audience nod, because this is who we are, the way we interact with people, visceral, interactive, expressive, the expression of who we are. Well, we have been trying to translate it from a business standpoint. How can we build value for the business in that way? If you have that visceral kind of reaction, there is a high probability you're going to create emotional impulse purchase. You go with a list of things to buy in a store, and you get out of the store with your cart full of things that you are not planning to buy. The interactive one is essentially emotional satisfaction and loyalty. It's line of people out of an Apple store to buy the latest iPad or iWatch even before they ever tried it. It's emotional loyalty to the brand. An expressive one is communication and spontaneous PR, is word of mouth, is people being so proud of being associated to the brand, they want to talk about it. And in a society where you know, it's in the social media society, it's so important not to talk about yourself as a brand, but having people becoming your brand ambassadors is the most powerful way of communication. This is purchase, repurchase, and recommend. Or if we go back to the user perspective, is the wow effect you want to have when you interact with a product or a brand, is that emotional engagement, and finally, is the pride of being associated to the product and the brand. This, if you are able to translate it in your business practice, in your product development, in your innovation, is so powerful. And you need to do it in an authentic way. It's not about chasing the latest trend, it's about doing it in a consistent way. Find the purpose of your product and your brand and stick to it across touch points, across geographies, with one story that you keep in time. More and more, we need to move from the bottom of this experience pyramid to the top, covering all the different aspects. We used to do innovation focusing on usability, reliability, and functionality. This is the world of utilitarian needs. In a world like, you know, like ours, it was about innovating with the next flavors, or with more or less sugar, or with more or less calories. In that world, we will compete, Pepsi will compete with another cola. Then we go up. Is the world of pleasure and convenience. Already in these words, pleasure, emotionality, convenience is more rational. So we go back to the analogy I was doing before. This is the world of the man's pace. Is the world of occasion of use. Is the world where you may consume a soda with your meal with your family or tailgating outside of a stadium when you walk to school. Is the world where you may consume that cola, but you may consume a juice, an energy drink, an alcoholic beverage. So we need to understand we're not competing just with our direct competitors, but with others that potentially can replace the world. This is the world where we need to be meaningful. We need to create pleasure and convenience and emotional attributes for people in that occasion of use, in that experience. But then, the most of the time, very you know, good companies stop even here. They don't go up. Up there, there is the world of dreams, meaning, aspiration. Is what I call the world of brand spaces. Is when them, that brand means something for you in society, transcended the product itself. Think about Apple and challenges the status quo, or brands like Nike. Is the world where we don't compete anymore just with another cola brand or another beverage brand. We start to compete with relevance, for relevance in the society. By the way, there is a fantastic power in that, because that, if you stand for something, that gives you also the possibility to expand outside of your category. And you can do magic things. And once again, the most obvious example of this is a consumer electronic company like Apple that's been expanding to music, to services, to a variety of different fields in the past years. Now, you can apply this kind of approach to the world of today. So the example I gave you are the examples of product and brands that are already in the market, but as you can imagine, we're working on the world of tomorrow. So we're applying that kind of approach to innovation, to what is the future of hydration, the future of retail, the future of mass customization, new technologies that are entering our field, 3D printing, or Internet of Things, and so on and so forth. I could talk for 5 hours more, but I think it's going to be more interesting now to have a conversation, so I invite Brian to the stage. Thank you.